Jodi Benson. I'm the original singing and speaking voice of Ariel, the Little Mermaid, for the Walt Disney Company, as well as Barbie for Toy Story 2 and 3.
Ask them my questions and get some answers. What's a fire and why does it, what's the word, burn? When's it my turn? Wouldn't I love to explore that shore above?
I'm good. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing so well, thank you. It's wonderful to get to be here with all of you, and I'm excited to see all these beautiful faces. So I appreciate you coming to my home and getting to hang out with me. And in this virtual world that we have, it's pretty amazing that we can kind of all hang out together. So all around the world, right?
Yes, all around the world. We have students from literally all around the world today, and we're very excited to be in your home virtually.
That's right. Welcome. This is my this is our school room. Homeschooled both of our kids between the two of them for nearly, I think, 13, 14 years in this room. So we've had a lot of wonderful, wonderful life going on in this room, and very grateful, very grateful.
Wonderful. I see that there are a lot of people in the chat box right now just showing you love. So
yes, hello, everybody.
They love you. You're so beautiful.
Oh, you're so kind. Good morning.
Just reading some of these comments. So guys, we can see your comments. So just keep that love coming and keep those comments coming.
Thank you.
Yes. So how is quarantine treating you right now, this COVID-19 situation?
I know, it's crazy, isn't it? You know, it's been challenging, as it has been for everyone. Of course, all of my work has been delayed for the entire year of 2020, because everything I do is large group events, of course, which is currently not safe. So all of my work has been postponed until probably February or March of 2021. Both of our kids are home immediately from college, so we're thankful to have them here and have them safe with us. So we've really just been trying to enjoy every day and take it one day at a time, enjoy time with the family. And we live in a beautiful area in North Georgia on Lake Lanier. So we've got the mountains, we're doing a lot of hiking, a lot of playing outside at the pool and the lake, and just trying to connect, stay connected with people that we love, and do it safely outside with distance. So we have to get creative, as everyone does. So it's been a challenging time, as I know it has been for everybody. But we are doing our best to find the daily joy and the daily laughter. So
yeah,
that's good. What we're trying to do.
yeah, you know, it's so difficult to find laughter in times like this, but to see to see how people are just finding creative ways to keep their families engaged and, you know, like you said, outside to the mountains and, you know, getting that fresh air is really wonderful.
Yes, getting outside.
The room that you're in right now, it has like a lot of light. Is there like is that
it's
light?
It's all glass.
Wow.
Yeah, it's all windows around this room that faces out to the lakes and to the mountains. So we kind of tried to make it a really bright room to be able to stay awake while we do schooling. You know, so keep us going here in the daylight. Yeah. It's been a blessing.
So you have two students in college?
Our son McKinley, he just graduated virtually from Savannah College of Art and Design in Atlanta as a filmmaker. We had an at-home graduation. Their virtual graduation was really fun for SCAD. It was around the world, and we were one of the host families that got to kind of dance and have a party at the end. They sent us confetti, they sent us all sorts of props, and we had a really good time. You know, you make the best of the situation. So he graduated with his BFA in film and television production, and then he just had his premiere on Monday night at a remote theater that we could have the cast and crew. Yes, so he had his premiere to his 20th film, I think, of his SCAD career. So he graduated in 3 years. Both of our kids did dual enrollment during high school here at the local university, Truett McConnell. So that knocked out a good year plus of all the general education courses. So he graduated. He's actually working on a TV pilot in Atlanta remotely. So that's fun. That's a blessing.
Mom's footsteps a little bit.
He's actually on the other side. It's amazing. He's a writer, a director, and editor. So that's really his passion. So he just went off to work right now today. They're doing a TV pilot that he's executive producing and he's writing. And then our daughter, Delaney, she just finished her freshman year at the University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music, CCM, as a musical theater major. So that, of course, shut down completely. And so she's been home this summer taking class, voice and dance, and doing everything that you can remotely, you know, as safely as you can. And then we don't know if she's going back yet. Hopefully in the next few weeks, we'll get all that information, whether they're online, whether they're a hybrid, whether it's safe to go back to campus or not. So we're kind of just trusting God and seeing what he has in store for her for this next semester.
Wonderful. I see a lot of people shaking their heads. Yeah. they're loving that you are a Christian and that you believe in God and that he has a part in your life. And I want to get to that a little bit later to talk about how that has shaped your career. But I think the thing that many people are wondering right now is, how did you begin this journey of singing? How did you start singing?
Well, long story short, I started singing when I was probably 5 years old. My sister taught me to play the guitar, and we used to sing at church in a guitar mass when I think it was 9 years old. So I started singing at church and playing the guitar and all that. And then once I got into high school, I started to do a few little, you know, shows here and there, musicals.
Well, I can relate. And then,
it was really fun. I had a really great time. And the transition between, you know, high school and college was really fun. I was able to kind of do a show in between graduation and starting. And that kind of sealed the deal for me that I thought, yeah, I'm going to just see what this is all about. So God provided a scholarship at Millikan University in Decatur, Illinois. I had to stay in state just with finances, and I'm from Illinois. So I was there for about a year and a quarter, and I had auditioned during my breaks of, you know, Christmas break and summer break to work. And I had gotten cast in a wonderful tour. So I left college early, and then I just kind of started working professionally. And then when I was doing Crazy for You on Broadway, I actually went back to college remotely and graduated 10 years later and did the walk and the cap and gown and the whole thing, which was really fun. So I just kind of fell into this career without really any experience or training at the beginning, but I kind of just felt like, you know, God had given me these gifts. I just wanted to use them and see where it would all go. And so just, it's been an incredible journey. And really, so my passion was Broadway, musical theater, of course. And I did a Broadway show called Smile with Howard Ashman and Marvin Hamlisch. Right. And when that show closed very suddenly after 6 weeks, Howard was already working with the Disney company on The Little Mermaid. So he invited all the girls to audition for Ariel and for anything that was going on. And it was very kind of him. And a year later, after I laid down my audition on a reel-to-reel, an old-fashioned reel-to-reel where you know, press play and record at the same time. And of course, none of the kids know what that is. But I got a call, you know, a year later that I had gotten the role of Ariel, which of course, by that time I had completely forgotten what it was that I had auditioned for a year before. And so there began my journey with Disney. And that was 33, 30, almost 34 years ago.
Wow, that is amazing.
I know, it's crazy.
So when would you say that you got, like, people always ask, Darrell, when did you get bit by the theater bug, right?
Right.
So when would you say that moment was when you got bit by the musical theater kind of
voice? I think it happened early when I was like 8, and I hadn't really done pretty much anything, but I had learned about what musical theater was, and I had learned about Broadway, and I thought, you know, I would love to sing and dance and act and pay the bills. You know, I don't want to be a star or a celebrity, and it's not about, about the money. I would like to be able to, you know, afford being able to live, basically, you know, just have your needs sort of met. And I think it was when I graduated from high school, I did a community theater production in my hometown of Rockford. West Side Story.
Okay.
It was West Side Story, and I played Maria, and it was interesting because I had never sung soprano before, ever. I had always been a big belter and had never had really any training or anything like that. So to have the role of this first soprano was quite challenging, scary, a little bit scary as well. And so I think when I did that show, I thought, I really, really enjoy this. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to go to college for training because I hadn't had any, you know, so I had my first voice teacher. Then I had had a couple voice lessons with somebody local, had maybe a handful of some dance classes when I was in high school, but really just experiencing doing some ensemble stuff in high school. Hadn't really, you know, done a role or anything like that until after I graduated. So I was a pretty late bloomer as far as training goes, but it's when I went to college, I thought that was really it for me at college. I was able to have my first training ever in all these areas and loved it so much that I thought, this is something, you know, let's just see where this goes. Let's see what God's going to do with that.
Yeah, it was really amazing that you continually put God in everything that you do. And then that really shapes the way that, you know, that you have your life. And I know that there are many people out there who are probably interested in musical theater, and some of you are probably in this room and you're thinking, well, it's too late for me. Well, we just heard a wonderful story from Jodi.
It's never too late.
It's never too late, you know, when you have
God's timing is perfect. You know, his timing is impeccable. It might be at the last minute. It might be at the 11th hour. My daughter and I were watching online church yesterday because my husband's out of town and my son was at a funeral. And so Delaney and I were watching her home church at college in Cincinnati online. And it was so powerful because he had interviewed four members of the church, just wonderful young people, and ask them, what crazy thing did you learn during COVID so far? What have you learned during this crazy time? And one of the people, the first woman, young lady, shared exactly what my heart was, which was, I'm learning how to completely surrender and learning how to really trust in God, not just with my words by saying, oh yeah, I trust God, but I've never really had to have that full impact of like, oh my gosh, I'm really going to trust him and I'm really going to surrender everything, because we as a family are, all four of us in the entertainment industry, of course, are really laying it all out. You know, we have no idea. It could be a year. It could be 2 years. Mm-hmm. We really don't know, you know, when God's going to recover our industry and our livelihood and our jobs, because we've all lost everything in our family. Right. So it's been an interesting road to learn how to completely surrender, not just with word alone, but in true action, to not worry or stress.
Right.
You know, be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God with thanksgiving. And then the promise is that we get to have the peace that surpasses all human understanding in our lives. But that is a daily process. It's something that we have to do daily. It's not just something that, you know, happens like that. So that's just something that I'm really, really, really learning right now, is how to not worry, not be fearful, not be anxious. Worry about nothing and pray about everything. And you know, even at my age, I'm learning and growing. And as all of you wonderful young people, I know the future looks a little scary right now, but this is a season. We're going to get through it, and we're going to get through it all together. So, you know, God's in control.
Yes, that's wonderful. You know, my mom says that all the time. God is in control. Have a focused and productive day. And we just continually keep that in our heart as we go along. You know, I'm very curious. So when you received the call that you got this part of Ariel, what was that like? Who called you? What was the reaction?
Yeah, well, it was back in 1986, 87. So I had a pager, and I was in New York City, and I had a pager on my hip that, you know, vibrates, and
I'm
a roll of quarters.
Don't know what a pager is.
They don't know what that is. We didn't have cell phones. And so there were pay phones on every block. And I had a roll, you know, you carry a roll of quarters in your backpack or your dance bag or whatever. And so I got a page that said, you know, call Nancy, my agent. And so I think it was like at 16th and Broadway or 14th and Broadway or Union Square area. And, you know, put my quarters in and called her from the payphone. And she said, you got the part. And I'm like, what part? And she's like, you got the part of Ariel. I'm like, what was that? Because it had been a year, you know, that had gone by. And I was like, oh, that's great. That's great. That'd be so much fun. You know, when do I start? And they said, well, we'll work out all the details. So it wasn't like this big, huge thing because I was doing other stuff. I was doing theater. I was doing Broadway. I was, you know, doing tours or whatever I was doing all during that time. And so I was like, okay, that's cool. You know, because back then animation was sort of frowned upon by the theater community, especially the New York community, that's what you did when your career was tanking and was at the end of your career and, you know, you couldn't be on Broadway anymore. So it didn't have the greatest way of looking at it in a positive light. And so when I would tell people, they're like, well, are you in the film? I mean, we're going to see you. I'm like, no, you're going to hear me. You know, it's a voiceover. And they're like, oh, okay. Well, you know, and my mom was kind of like, well, better luck next time. You know, let me know when you're really in a film and I can see you. So with that reaction, I just kind of stopped telling everybody what I was doing.
So my question is, so basically, did you expect that this animation would blow up this much then?
No. In fact, they were not going to announce who we were. They weren't going to reveal our faces or our names. It was just going to roll the credits at the end, not even in front of the picture starting. So it was basically just going to be a speed roll at the end of the credit. So you'd have to stop it when you get your VHS to kind of like figure out who was who.
Right.
It was never really going to be publicized or anything like that. It was truly going to be in a Disney fashion, like in our classic films, where you don't focus on who the person is. You focus on the character and the film. So about, let's see, we opened in November. So I want to say it must have been at the end of September. I got a call from Disney that said, we want to send you on a press tour. And I'm like, why? You know, well, we want to get you out there. So I hit like 22 cities in 20 days. I went coast to coast and I just did a ton of press and publicity. And of course, at that point, the face and the name was connected with the character. And I was just so confused at what was going on. I mean, I knew that Disney Feature Animation had moved off the lot. And because when I would go to work, and I'd see my animator, Glenn Keane. He was in these sort of portable mobile buildings on Flower Street in Glendale. They weren't on the lot. And I knew that Disney Animation was in a huge transition period. Right. And there was even some concern that, you know, what would it look like in the future? Would it exist in the future? What is that all about? Mm-hmm. So I knew that element of it, but I had no idea that so much was riding on this film in particular. I was not aware of that. We were not aware. I mean, obviously, I'd see all the powers that be with Disney that would come to our first few days and our first week of recording. And we approached it because of Howard and Alan, we approached it like a Broadway show. So we all sat together in a circle and did a couple of read-throughs. And then we started recording simultaneously between plexiglass.
Right.
And which was, you know, unheard of, I think, at the time. I think Howard and Alan brought Broadway, you know, to Disney to blend these worlds together. So it was a huge surprise to go on press tour. And then it was a huge surprise that, you know, the critics went crazy. And then all of a sudden, here we are, this, you know, golden age of animation, the Renaissance, it's the renewal, the rebirth, you know, we're starting all over again.
Yeah.
And, you know, we had no clue that was happening at all. Yeah. We had no clue. So It was a wonderful blessing and a huge, huge surprise.
Yeah. I mean, here we are 30 years later, and we saw that recently you celebrated the 30th anniversary.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Of being Princess Ariel.
Yeah.
So what was that like, during this celebration?
Right. It was so much fun. It was last summer. I'm so thankful that it wasn't this summer, because obviously it would have all been virtual. But we did a huge celebration at D23. D23 is our amazing fan event that we have during the summer out in Anaheim at the Anaheim Convention Center. And we have fans from all over the world. I don't know how many walked through that door over the course of the 3 or 4 days, but it's amazing. So I was able to host a 30th anniversary celebration.
Amazing.
With with our creators and our animators and our directors. And unfortunately, we didn't have any of our cast members there besides me, but we did have Pat Carroll and we did have Sam that kind of came in virtually, to join us. But it was really magical. It was really wonderful. And we're on 4 generations, maybe 5 generations now. Because I'll have great grandparents, the parent and the child. So I'll have 4 generations that will come. When I do live fan events around the U.S., I will have 4 generations that'll come up to meet me. Pretty magical.
Yes, that is magical. I see so many students in the chat box right now just showing you love and just talking about. One student said, congratulations on the 30th anniversary for Ariel.
Thank you.
So amazing. They love you so much. Congratulations. So proud of you. You're doing good work. Keep it up. And they love you.
Oh, that's very sweet.
Oren said that. And so we're kind of coming to a close of the interview. So I just want to ask a few more questions before we finish up. So my questions are going to be pertaining to, you mentioned Howard Ashman a few times. Mm-hmm. So for those of you who don't know who Howard Ashman is, he's a very famous lyricist who wrote the original songs for The Little Mermaid, Aladdin, Sleeping, Beauty and the Beast, and the original songs like Under the Sea, Belle, Friend Like Me, Be Our Guest, and many other songs. Mm-hmm. And so Jodi had the opportunity to actually work with him on the music that she sang for The Little Mermaid. Yeah, and so, I watched a video of them working together and it just blew me away. As an actor and as a dancer, to see your connection to the lyricist and to the composer of the music was very engaging and very nice. Mm-hmm. I really loved it. And so what was that experience like for you as you worked with Howard Ashman?
Well, Howard was an absolute genius. He was actually my director and my lyricist for my Broadway musical called Smile. And so we had worked together for almost 4 years on that particular project. So we got to be very good friends as well as coworkers. And I knew everything about how he directed. And so he was one of our executive producers for The Little Mermaid, as well as the lyricist. Now he wasn't the director, because that's actually Ron and John Musker and Ron Clements. But Ron and John were so wise and realized that Howard and I had a unique connection working together as director and actress, that they just allowed him to come into the studio with me, and he directed my entire performance. Not just my vocals, but all of my dialogue as well. And he played all the parts. So he'd come into the studio with me and he would read with me, get me to the place I needed to be emotionally, whether it's with Triton and I'm sobbing and I'm crying. He played Ursula, he played Flounder, he played everybody. And he was just an absolute genius, because he was an actor himself. That's really what his training was initially. And but so brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And so far ahead of his time that he blew Disney away. I mean, they didn't even know how to kind of handle this force that came in that was so driven, such an incredible perfectionist, and how he knew everything about The Little Mermaid. So if anybody had a question, you would go to Howard. And I loved how Ron and John, as our animators and as our directors, would allow Howard to be Howard. And that's what made our film so special, is because of Howard's stamp. Everything about it, everything about Ariel is Howard. Wow. Every interpretation of the lyric of Part of Your World and my dialogue really has Howard, you know, infused in Ariel. And so we had so much fun. I had so much respect for him in the studio. And because we had that working relationship on a Broadway musical, I knew how he communicated to me. I understood the way that he would speak to me. And I think you can see that when we're in the studio, it's we have some banter back and forth, but I knew what he would need. He knew how to get me there emotionally, and he knew how to pull everything from me to get the best work possible.
Good. If you haven't seen that video on YouTube, you all have to check out that video. It's a really amazing video.
It's actually on August 7th. We have a huge release on Disney Plus. If any of you are part of Disney Plus, there is a documentary called Howard. Yes. And it was written and created by Don Hahn, who was the director of Beauty and the Beast and also a dear friend of Howard. You need to watch that. It just gives you so much understanding of who he was. And I'm excited that the world gets to know Howard and gets to meet Howard through this documentary, because I think it'll help you even appreciate his work even more.
Yeah, and I think not many people understand what it takes to be able to play Ariel or any other character. But right. I saw how well you and Howard, Mr. Howard, worked together. And so my question to you is, how important is it to be able to listen and to be able to receive direction
as an
actress and as a person in your life?
Yeah. Absolutely. For all of us, just as human beings, we need to be teachable. We do need to. I mean, that's why God gave us two ears and one mouth, right? because how important is it for us as humans, but as believers, to really be able to hear? We need to be able to empathize. We need to be able to be compassionate. Mm-hmm. And when we are good listeners, we're good learners. And when we can hear well and we can translate that into our heart. And for me as an actress, you know, you're nothing if you can't listen to your director or anybody that is in authority over you in your performance. The wise choice is to listen well and then be able to translate what has been communicated to be able to give the product that everybody wants and what they're looking for. That's my job. Yeah. I need to be able to take in the information, process it, but then I need to make that change and exhibit that change. I need to show that change. So I think for all of us, we're all students, you know, we're all in a learning process. So.
Yes, yes. And so how important is it to know the mindset of the composer? You had the lyricist there, and of course mm-hmm. he didn't write the whole, you know, script, but he right. embodied that, as you were saying, he played all the mm-hmm. characters, he knew about right. Ariel. How important is it to know the mindset of the composers as you sing the music?
Right. You it's very, very important. You need to hear the heart of the directors and the producers. So right away, they'll present the piece to us of The Little Mermaid, and they're showing us a dog and pony show with little sketches. So from every animator, from both of the directors, from Howard, from Alan, and from the producers, the executive producers that we had for on staff at Disney at the time, it's very important to listen, to hear their heart and each one of the important aspects that they are trying to communicate, so that I got to take in all that information from everybody, and we need to come up together jointly in a team effort of how Ariel is going to come to life. Right. And the animator Glenn Keane was really impressive how he explained it to me, that, you know, he had sketches and he had some things going on with Ariel, but it wasn't until he heard my voice that he realized now Ariel has come to life. Ariel has been born. And so for him to have the gift of being able to listen to my voice and what I can bring to Ariel, but it really is a team effort. And I think as teacher and student, even that relationship is a team effort. You need to be able to listen and to respond and give and take and be respectful and compassionate and empathetic with one another.
Yeah, that's wonderful. That's absolutely right. IYF tries to teach a lot about mindset. It's wonderful mm-hmm. to see that, how important mindset is in the right. real world, and how right. To have that exchange of heart is also very mm-hmm. important.
Yeah. And that's the only way that you can really be authentic, and that you can be vulnerable, and that you can actually be real. You know, in order to even have relationship with people, whether it's work, whether it's school, whether it's family, whether it's friends, we have to be relatable, which means we have to be authentic, we have to be vulnerable, and we've got to be real, because everyone can read between the lines when you're faking it. And, you know, you can read between the lines if I'm singing a song and you're not buying it, you know, you're not believing it. I have to believe in my heart what I'm trying to communicate, whether it's through song or through word. I've got to believe it before you're ever going to believe what I'm doing. You know, I have to believe that first. And same for us to communicate. If we want real relationship with people, we have to be real, which means we've got to be vulnerable, right? Yeah. I mean, we have to take some risks and some chances. And because you can read between the lines when you have a friend, you know, that may not be real. It feels a little fake.
I'm sure you've experienced that a lot.
Oh yeah, I have the gift of discernment. So it's one of my spiritual gifts that God has given me, is a gift of discernment. Mm-hmm. So I can read a room right when I walk into it. I can read people. Yeah. And I can be like, oh, that's not real. I get a red flag on that. I need to be careful with that one. Sometimes that gift is a little challenging to have. I wish I didn't have it all the time, but but it does keep me very vulnerable, and it also protects me and protects my family. So it's a good gift.
Well, we're going to open it up for Q&A. I see a lot of students are kind of, raising their hands right now. So we're going to open it up for Q&A, and then I see there's people asking questions. They're ready. They were waiting for this moment.
Okay.
Okay, wonderful. So we're going to first, I think the first person that I saw raise their hand was Unmi. I'm not sure if she still has her hand raised right now. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to physically go through the pages. And if you guys could just physically raise your hand, I'll unmute you to ask questions. So if you have a question, just raise your hand physically like this. And then I can unmute you and you can ask Jodi your question. Okay, so I have Jakat here. So I'm going to unmute Jakat, and Jakat, you can ask your question.
Hello.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good. I'm actually excited that I got to, like, I'm going to get to ask you a question. You spoke a lot about Mr. Howard Ashman, and I was like really surprised as to how much your working relationship and how how deep it was,
right?
In order to bring out the best in the character that you were playing, and I guess it's a part two question. It's like, number one, do you consider him your mentor? And part B of that question is, how did that experience affect the rest of your work that you were able to do?
Great. Those are great, great questions, Jakat. I really appreciate that. The first thing is because he was a genius, he was a perfectionist. And just that opportunity of working with him, I just felt like I was a sponge kind of soaking in all of this information from him. So I was constantly like a student, just kind of like wide-eyed and looking up at him, taking it all in, because I knew that this was really precious and this was really, really special. And because I had had the opportunity not just on one big Broadway musical, which was so life-changing for me, then to do The Little Mermaid with him. It's like we had this journey together going from Broadway to animation. So it was really special to get to make that transition together. We weren't friends in that we socialized outside of work. You know, that we weren't those kinds of friends. It was just this tremendous respect that I had for him. And I'm just so grateful for that. The thing that I learned from Howard that has carved in my heart for the future of my career is learning to be a perfectionist, but learning to let go. And he gave me such a gift because I came into The Little Mermaid being an extreme perfectionist, and I wanted to have the control. Sorry, my nose is running. And I wanted to have the control of everything. And because I had Howard at the helm, I was able to let go of my performance and like give it to him, because he'd be like, Jodi, I've got this. You know, I've got this. And so I would record and I'd do my lines and I wouldn't go back and listen to anything. Now they would invite me to come in, but I'd be like, no, because I trusted him. And I learned that huge lesson of letting go and trusting the people in authority over me, just me doing my job. Like I used to think about just my job, and then I'd add everybody else's job on top of it. And then I'd be worrying about everybody's job. Like, are you all doing your part? And I think working with Howard and him being such a genius, looking at me going, Jodi, I got this. You just do your one thing and do it well. And then let all of the rest of us do our things really well. And that was the first time I'd ever done that, where I worked and then I just handed it over and I let it go, to the point where I didn't see the film until like the screening. And he had come up to me, he goes, this is your first time to see the whole film. Now, I didn't know what they had selected, which takes they had selected, what vocal tracks they had selected. And he goes, you're probably not going to like it because it's not perfect, but it's perfect for Ariel. Saying that to me, I was like, oh my gosh. And when I started watching the film, I totally forgot that it was me. I totally forgot that it was Jodi. I just got wrapped up in Ariel. And that was the key to a great film, that you forget about who the voices were. So that was a great question. Yeah, I learned such wonderful skills from him that I have carried on since then, that I'm grateful for. I appreciate your question, Jakat. It was wonderful.
Jakat, that was a really wonderful question. And Jodi, thank you so much for answering that question.
Thank you.
That was very, very insightful to know that how important it is to have that mentor and for you to be able to put everything else down and trust him.
Yeah,
that's very powerful. I'm even learning
as
I'm listening to you. Wow, that's really wonderful.
It's a hard thing to do.
Yeah, it is.
It's hard. It's very hard to do, but you know, really focusing on what I do well and then trusting others in their gifts and what they do well, you know.
Wonderful. That's wonderful. So I think many students are probably wondering if you could just sing a little snippet for us.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. I'd be happy to. I haven't warmed up here. Let's see. Make sure I can sing here. Okay. What would I give to live where you are? What would I pay to stay here beside you? What would I do to see you smiling at me? Where would we walk? Where would we run if we could stay all day in the sun? Just you and me, and I could be part of your world. I don't know when, I don't know how, but I know something's starting right now. Watch and you'll see. Someday I'll be part of your world.
Wow, everyone, please give her some reactions. Really wonderful. Oh my God.
Oh, thank you. Wonderful. You're so sweet. I appreciate that.
And I'm not the only one. You see so many people in the chat box right now. They're saying wonderful. They're in tears.
Yes, I can see that. That's amazing. So sweet.
This is a dream. oh my God. They're just so excited. Thank you so much. We just love that you taking your time out today to be with us and to share your gift and your love and your passion and your faith with us and your voice with us and your home with us. Yes. We appreciate it. It was just really wonderful.
I know we didn't get to everybody's questions, and I apologize. Yeah. It's always hard on Zoom with the clock tick, 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 tick. But, you know, I really do appreciate all of the wonderful people and all of your wonderful questions and your comments. You guys are so sweet. I really appreciate that.
Yes. Before we conclude, I just want to ask if we could just take a picture.
Absolutely.
We have several pictures, several pages on Zoom right now, but
yes,
click through each page and kind of take some pictures.
Absolutely. And then you got to send them to me.
For sure.
I want some pictures.
Sure. So if you all can hold up in some hearts, you see your two fingers make a heart, or you can make a heart like this, or you can make a heart like this. Or you can just smile and put a peace sign, anything. Just show your beautiful faces, and we're going to take some pictures.
Awesome.
Okay, so everybody smile. Okay, it's going to take a few seconds. Keep smiling. Wow, so many wonderful faces. I'm clicking through this. So many beautiful faces. You're going to hear a camera sound. Wow. Thank you so much, everyone. We took all of the pictures.
That's awesome. You'll have to send those to me.
Yes, Jodi, we're going to put all those pictures together, and we're going to send those to you. Thank you so much, Jodi, for spending time with us. Everyone, thank you for joining us.
Thank you guys for having me. I appreciate it.
Jodi, do you want to just say anything else before we log off?
Yeah, I just want to say God bless each and every one of you. I know we're in a crazy season right now, but hold on to Jesus. He's got this. He's in control of your life. He's in control of the pandemic. He's in control of all the strife going on in our world right now. He's bigger. He's bigger than everything. So let's all just cling to Jesus. Let's worry about nothing, and let's pray about everything, and let's do it together. So God bless every one of you.
Thank you so much, Jodi. Thank you so much, everyone. This will conclude our time. You're going to be heading over to your next schedule. Everyone, let's just give Jodi one more big round of applause.
God bless you guys.
Show her some more love in the chat box.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.